I think you'll agree that by putting in those inversions, the chords now have some sense of forward movement and progression in them. You may also have recognised to what song this famous progression belongs.
When are you gonna come down? When are you going to land? I should have stayed on the phone. I should have listened to my own mind. You know you can't hold me forever. I didn't sign up. Too young to be singing the blues.
In all the examples of bass lines we've encountered so far, the bass has been a loyal and meek servant of the harmony and of the melody. It's always been a member of the supporting cast and never the star. But during the 19th century, the bass emerged from the shadows and it began to have an important independent voice of its own. This transformation in its fortunes had its roots in an unlikely source.
Believe it or not, historians have located it in the waltz.
Think of the waltz, and you don't perhaps think of bass lines, but something happened to the bass in the waltz that, though it seemed insignificant at first, was to have considerable impact on the future of the bass as time went on. Listen to this waltz, Roses from the South, by Johann Strauss the Younger, the fat boy slim of the 1870s.
In this excerpt, two musical phrases will be linked together by a little solo moment from all the bass instruments. Here it is.
It may not seem that earth-shattering, but these little linky bits were to have quite an impact. The point of them was to allow a transition from one section of the waltz to another. Musically, they might change key, and in terms of the dance floor, they were there to allow you to reset your feet for the next set of moves.
Here's the bass link. And here's another one.
From these modest beginnings, the bass began its advance. The next staging post in its journey was the craze for marching band music that swept the USA in the late 19th century. The greatest of the American band composers was John Philip Sousa, and in this, his early march, The Globe and the Eagle, the humble bass bridge first heard in the waltz, now turbocharged with trombones and tubas, asserts itself with a vengeance.
This very same trick of joining two sections with a mini bass solo was adopted by tuba and double bass players in early jazz, many of whom were ex-marching band members themselves. These links were given nicknames like the bass filler or the bass run. From these humble beginnings, the bass solo and indeed the bass riff were born. Riffs are distinctive little nuggets of tune which might begin a song or form the basis of a section of a song. There are hundreds of incredibly well-known riffs in popular music, like these. some bass riffs, there's an unmistakable feeling that we're waiting for something else to happen. For the voice to soar in over the top, for the key to change, for the drums to join in, or the guitar to begin a solo. There are other examples of bass solos being much more than that. Post-war jazz saw the appearance of virtuoso bassists in small bands whose role was far from that of supporting stooge. Miles Davis's So What, from his influential 1959 album Kind of Blue, features a bass solo from Paul Chambers that underpins and shapes the whole piece. Jazz bass players' attitude to their role, that they were no longer mere bricks and mortar for the other players to stand on, was to redefine what we expect as listeners from bass in contemporary music. Music, the most influential bass playing came from the house band of Tamla Motown, the Funk Brothers. Its bass maestro was the great James Jamerson. Most, if not all of you, will know the 1967 Marvin Gaye hit, I Heard It Through the Grapevine. But it was first recorded for Tamla by Gladys Knight and the Pips. And what gave that original recording such energy and drive was the way James Jamerson played the bass line. Take the chorus, for example, which is based on just two simple chords, C and F. Now, an unimaginative bass player would simply thrash out the roots of those chords one after another, like this. Jamerson turns the bass line into a fireball, leaping about all over the place to create movement and excitement in the accompaniment. By giving such life to the bass line, Jamerson turned the bass from a meek accompanying instrument into a chief ingredient in the success of hit songs. From the 1950s onwards, amplification allowed the previously rather quiet bass guitar to cut through all the other instruments. Then, in the 1960s, it was the turn of the keyboard to be revolutionized through technology. Up until then, only the mighty organ was capable of playing the lowest notes. That was about to change. Bass notes as low as those to be found on the organ only really entered the musical mainstream with the invention of Robert Moog's revolutionary synthesizer, whose arrival into the public arena occurred in 1968 with the release of this record. An album called Switched on Bach, in which pieces were performed on a Moog synthesizer by Wendy Carlos, caused a sensation. But although the breakthrough featured classical music, it was in popular music that the synthesizer was to play a starring role. What began life as a tangled web of wires, knobs and circuits soon developed into this nifty little box known as a mini Moog.